Live at 5, this is 13 News Now.
Another chilly day forced people to bundle up out there on the streets of downtown Norfolk. We spent much of the day in the 40s.
And there's a chance of rain tonight and a chance for a wintry mix tomorrow. Jeff is leading our coverage.
Yeah, this is the storm we have been talking about for, I think, at least a week when we started talking about this major pattern change. And it's out there. A lot of clouds also out there. And speaking of something else that's out there, some rain starting to move gradually back to the north as we go through the evening. We had a couple of isolated showers in the area today. Most of it has been down in North Carolina, as you can clearly see. Pretty nasty and raw day down there. That's the kind of weather that's going to fill in and start to move to the north. So right now, temperatures at 47 degrees, winds out of the west-southwest at 5, and the barometric pressure is falling. So where do we go from here? Well, the timing is late tonight, early Friday, through Saturday morning, maybe even into Saturday afternoon. If we get a mix here, or a significant mix, in the local area, sort of the seven cities, if you will, it would be during the afternoon, mainly on Saturday, as some cold air comes back in. Near the coastline, mainly rain. Back inland, these numbers certainly could change. It'll depend on if we get some heavier bursts. Those could cause a little bit of a slushy mix on the ground at times. And I wouldn't rule out even a couple of inches. That's probably not the most likely scenario, but it is certainly possible. The ground's warm. It was 70 degrees a few days ago. So that is something obviously we'll watch for, is exactly where that front sets up, where the sort of mixed line or rain snow line ends up. But for now, expect at least a little bit of winter weather across parts of the area.
Thanks, Jeff. With that chance of winter weather in our forecast, preparations are underway ahead of the first flakes. VDOT crews are already doing test runs with salt trucks and spreaders. 13 News Now reporter Jemmy Lee got a look at VDOT's operation today in Norfolk. And Jemmy, what does VDOT have planned at this particular point?
Hey, David, crews tell me that they are equipped and ready to take on this winter season. This weekend, however, they don't plan on treating the roadways because they expect that wintry mix to hit the ground and not cause too much trouble on the roadways. However, if the forecast takes a turn, they tell me they are ready. Dump trucks, plows, spreaders, and mixers. VDOT is equipped with over 460 pieces of equipment for this winter season.
In our district, we have about 24,000 tons of salt, about 14,000 tons of sand.
Since October, crews have been busy prepping. Drivers have been taking dry runs, going over their routes with a fine-tooth comb.
They check for curbs, they check for manhole covers, things that you may not see if we get a heavy snow.
VDOT says it's ready to do its part, but it needs drivers to do theirs too.
We do see drivers racing in between the two vehicles.
Be careful, keep a wide range between them and the dump trucks.
The agency also took time to educate students about safety in its Paint the Plow program.
It enables us to get out and see the schools and let the children see what a plow is like, what the trucks are like, how big it is.
Hampton Roads' budget of $5.3 million is smaller than last year's budget of $6 million. But VDOT says it's not worried. Safety always comes first. If there's snow, they'll plow no matter what, even if they exceed their budget.
We'll find the money to cover that, whether it be from the central office or within our own district funds.
And not only will VDOT pull money from other funds, if the weather does get really bad this winter, they'll ask other districts for help. Live in Norfolk, I'm Jemmy Lee, 13 News Now.
With the cold temperatures, it's important for people who need shelter to find a place to stay. In Virginia Beach, an overnight shelter is available for homeless people. If you know someone who needs a place to stay, they should check in at the Lighthouse Day Support Services Center near the oceanfront before 7 p.m. each day. Space is provided on a first-come, first-served basis.
13 News Now is digging deeper into a national concern. We've told you about issues with how the military reports crimes by service members. They came to light after the Texas church shooting last month. The gunman, Devin Kelly, killed 26 people. The Air Force court-martialed Kelly for assault against his wife and stepson, but officials failed to report the conviction to the FBI. That lapse allowed him to get a gun. Now we've learned this problem is spread throughout the military. 13 News Now investigative reporter Laura Geller has a concrete look at the numbers.
Well, let's be specific here. We're talking about times military branches were supposed to submit fingerprints and final reports of service members convicted in court martials for certain offenses. The military's own rules require that information go to the FBI. But a new report shows throughout all branches, about 30% of the time, that is not happening.
DOD's Office of the Inspector General looked at 2 years' worth of information, checking to see if military law enforcement is submitting the details Pentagon rules require. Here are the Navy findings. 29% of fingerprint cards were not submitted. And for the final disposition of convictions in court martials, that number jumps to 36% not submitted. That means in about 3 out of every 10 cases, the FBI is not getting the information it needs. The OIG says the consequences are real. The failure to populate the database can allow someone to purchase a weapon who should not, hinder criminal investigations, and potentially impact law enforcement and national security interests. According to the report, Navy leadership agreed with recommendations to fix the issue and move forward. They include submitting info not in the system, reviewing the information to make sure it meets requirements, and ensuring there is strict oversight. But Congressman Scott Taylor wants to go a step further.
They haven't been able to do it thus far in a responsible way, I believe. So it's important for us to take action.
A bill he is sponsoring says if someone is convicted or admits guilt of domestic violence, the Pentagon is required to report it to the FBI within 3 days.
The message to the military is to, it's to get your act together, quite frankly, and to make sure that they're abiding by not just that policy, but what will hopefully be law as well, so that we can protect folks.
And right now, according to the report, DOD is not following its own rules. So we asked Congressman Taylor how his bill would ensure officials follow what would become law. He'll explain the consequences new at 6. Laura Geller, 13 News Now.
The case for a man accused of shooting a Virginia Beach police detective is moving forward. Today, a judge certified an attempted capital murder charge for 46-year-old Brian Cage. He was wheeled into court for his first in-person appearance. The wounded officer testified about the morning last summer when he confronted Cage at a home on Ohio Avenue. He said as officers were serving a search warrant for child pornography, Cage rapidly fired at least 50 rounds. The officer was shot twice in the shoulder. He might not be able to return to full duty until the end of next year. The case now goes to a grand jury.
Staying in Virginia Beach, the man accused of trying to assault a TCC professor in a bathroom also appeared in court today. For the first time, we heard from the woman who says Jared Jones held a gun to her head at the Virginia Beach campus. She says she thought she was going to die that day in June, screaming for her life. Jones allegedly ran off and was arrested days later. The adjunct professor said she was familiar with Jones, a former student at the campus, but was shocked when he confronted her in the woman's bathroom. A judge certified misdemeanor and felony firearm charges against Jones. An abduction charge was dropped.
New information on a Newport News school bus crash. Police officers say they cited one driver for this wreck last night at Jefferson Avenue and City Center Boulevard. We're told a car was making a right turn onto Jefferson, forcing another car to swerve into a school bus. The bus crossed the center median and hit another car. Firefighters had to extract that last driver, and medics took that person to a hospital. The driver of the car that made the right turn got a summons for reckless driving. No students were on the school bus.
State troopers recovering from an accident on the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel. This is a picture of the trooper's smashed cruiser. State police tell us the trooper was driving southbound out of the second tunnel. That's when a construction vehicle reportedly pulled into the trooper's lane and the vehicles collided. The officer has minor injuries.